It's Friday, June 25. This is the news on PBCJ. I'm Simone Absalom Gale. Tourism Minister Edmund Bartlett is calling on global and regional tourism stakeholders to redouble their efforts to facilitate the speedy recovery of the international tourism industry and, by extension, the global economy. Minister Bartlett made the call as he chaired the blended staging of the United Nations World Tourism Organization's 66th Regional Commission of the Americas on Thursday. Minister of Tourism for Saudi Arabia, His Excellency Ahmed Al-Khatib, and Minister of Tourism and International Transport for Barbados, Senator Lisa Cummins, are among the global tourism leaders who have traveled to Jamaica to attend the CAM meeting. Minister Bartlett highlighted that international tourism receipts in 2020 declined by 64% in real terms, equivalent to a drop of over $900 billion, while the total loss in export revenues from international tourism amounts to nearly $1.1 trillion. While hoping for more positive trends moving forward, Mr. Bartlett stressed that, quote, the call now is to redouble our efforts to work together in practical and meaningful ways for a return to the successful days of travel and tourism, end quote. Prime Minister Andrew Holness says his administration is working to build a society that balances alleviating poverty, creating prosperity, and preserving the environment. He discussed the issue this week while speaking at a virtual ceremony for the signing of a memorandum of understanding between the government and Caribbean Cement Company Limited for the entity to use end-of-life pneumatic tires in the cement production process. The Prime Minister says once employment numbers increase, people will be open to learning about environment management.
When they get income, they get employment, they are engaged productively, we are then able to engage them with information so that they themselves can become stewards of the environment.
Mr. Holness says the government is doing its part in pushing the narrative through legislation, like the ban on single-use plastic bags, and there's more to come. The Prime Minister says a team is in place to create a waste-to-energy plan for the country.
It is not a simple issue. It's a very complex matter. We have had support of several of our multilateral partners in studying, and I am given assurances that in short order, I will be able to come to the country and declare a pathway towards developing a sustainable waste-to-energy strategy for Jamaica.
He says the plan would see, among other things, a strategy for the conversion of waste to electricity and possibly moving the Riverton City landfill to another more suitable location.
The introduction of nationally required separation of plastics, which we have started on, by the way. The Ministry of Local Government, through the NSWMA, has started a pilot project, well, several pilot projects in several areas in Jamaica, supported initially by the government of Japan, and we make note of that. And in several communities across Jamaica, we are seeing separation of plastics taking place in anticipation, of course, of moving towards broad-scale waste-to-energy strategy for Jamaica.
According to Mr. Holness, the major challenge in his administration's move towards sustainable environmental management is bureaucracy.
We put things in place from 2017 going into 2018, but it has just taken too long. We need to move these innovative things, these innovative ideas, much more quickly through our government. That is the greatest challenge. If it is one thing from our culture that I would like to see transition into our bureaucracy, into our thinking, is speed. And that is what we should make our motto, you know. We should just make business at the speed of thought.
He says Jamaica's bureaucratic system is not one that takes risk.
The question is always, if I do this, there is no template for it. It is something new. If something goes wrong, who is going to get blamed? And, you know, I don't want to go before the PAAC or the PAC to have my name called up in media. So nobody is taking any risk. So everybody is going to, you know, wait till everything is perfected. And of course, people who are in business know that if you don't take some risk, there will be no reward.
Prime Minister Holness says this week's move to sign an MOU with Caribbean Cement Company is a pivot towards renewable energy, as it will see the 185,700 tires collected at the Riverton landfill per year being put to use. Government Senator Don Wehby opened the State of the Nation's debate on Friday. The House of Representatives concluded its sectoral debate in Parliament last week. Its conclusion is usually followed by the Upper House's State of the Nation debates. The opposition's spokesperson on tourism, Senator Janice Allen, was also scheduled to address the House. According to JIS, the State of the Nation debate gives cabinet ministers in the Senate an opportunity to address their portfolio responsibilities while highlighting government policies and programs. All senators are allowed to contribute to the State of the Nation debate. International Reggae Day will be celebrated in a few days on July 1. Here at PBCJ, we take the time to reflect on some of the artists that have contributed to the development of our signature music over the years. One such person is the late Frederick Toots Hibbert. The iconic singer died on September 11, 2020, to honor his rich legacy. Entertainment, Sport, Culture and Gender Minister Olivia Grange spearheaded a tribute concert last November for the man considered an institution in the industry. Marlon Samuels provides the highlights in this rebroadcast.
The star-studded lineup for the Toots Tribute to Cultural Icon concert was backed by the incredible reggae band Fab Five. The musical acts included Toots Hibbert's daughter, along with some of the biggest reggae acts celebrating his life and musical works.
Hear the man say, pressure drop on you.
Reggae pioneer Martha Griffiths also performed her favorite Toots Hibbert song. Others, including Willie Nelson, in paying homage, spoke of their unique partnership with Toots, his influence on them, and reggae.
He was a great guy, great musician. We did an album together, we hung out together. So, have a good trip, Toots. I don't own no land.
I've got muscle and I've got brain. I don't mind the sun and the rain. I gotta make a little change, as I'm a worried, worried, worried man.
Toots meant reggae.
He was truly Jamaica's Picasso of music.
Toots meant funk.
And that voice is such a gift. I mean, there are so few of the people left who have a direct connection to where the music started.
Toots was a we are ahead of everything.
I'm glad during the last part of his career, he was making new music.
His music is revolutionary, really.
The tribute concert celebrated his musical legacy and his life.
His humility was something that just pulled everybody in to appreciating him and loving him. When I think of those who have paved the way so that Jamaica could be outstanding right across the world for its music, particularly reggae music, I can think of Toots.
Are they
Toots helped to establish the Jamaica Festival Song Competition, Toots was the first winner. And to see that 50-odd years after, Toots Hibbert decided that he would enter the competition again.
Eternal Father, bless our land.
Just to help to resuscitate it, to revive it, to send the message that this is an important competition, it's an important brand, and he wanted people to give it the support.
He was passionate about music as well as his relationship with others, which endeared him to Jamaica and the world.
If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold.
We at the PBCJ joined with his family and the world in honoring cultural icon Frederick Toots Hibbert. For the news on PBCJ, I am Marlon Samuels.
My name is Toots and the Maters, the inventor for the world ready.
The recent JPS rate increase request is now being reviewed by the Office of Utilities Regulation, the OUR. Business Report host Gabriel Thompson explores this and other news. Plus, we give you the regular market updates in this extended episode.
The Office of Utilities Regulation, OUR, says it is currently reviewing an application from the Jamaica Public Service Company Limited, JPS, for a tariff adjustment. If approved, the total bill impact for residential customers would be 3.8% and 2.2% for small businesses. The OUR says it expects to make a decision by September. The regulator said this is JPS's first application for an annual tariff adjustment since the conclusion of its 2019 to 2024 JPS tariff review process last December. It says the 2021 filing is in keeping with the annual tariff review provision in the Electricity License 2016, which allows for adjustments to the company's revenue targets each year over the life of the five-year tariff to account for movements in factors such as inflation, the foreign exchange rate, and JPS's technical performance. JPS is also proposing the following: an average adjustment of 3.5% of the non-fuel tariff, bill movement for large commercial and industrial customers rate 40 and rate 50, which would see increases in the range of 3% to 4% respectively. Upward bill movement of 4.3% for very large-scale businesses rate 70 standard customers. A 3.5% increase for rate 70 customers using a time-of-use rate structure. The utility provider has also proposed an annual non-fuel revenue target for 2021 of over 49.1 million Jamaican dollars versus its non-fuel revenue projection of over 43.7 million Jamaican dollars should the existing tariff remain unchanged. The Office of Utilities Regulation says following its 2019 to 2024 JPS tariff determination notice in December, JPS appealed a number of the regulator's decisions to the Electricity Tribunal. It says some of these matters were raised in the company's 2021 application and are still pending before the tribunal. Select tax offices across the island will be open on Saturday, June 26, 2021, and every last Saturday of the month for the remainder of the 2021-22 financial year. The Tax Administration Jamaica TAJ says the service enhancement will provide taxpayers with a convenient option of doing business on the weekends. The following tax offices will operate this Saturday between the hours of 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Crossroads, Mandeville, Savannah Lamar, St. Anne's Bay, and Old Harbor. The Portmore Tax Office will continue its usual weekly Saturday operations with adjusted business hours of 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. Taxpayers should note that the operating times may be subject to adjustments resulting from announced curfew hours in keeping with the Disaster Risk Management Act. Persons wishing to make payments for property tax may opt to utilize the added convenience of TAJ's weekend operating hours as they have until June 30 before any penalty may be applied. Additionally, motorists who have not as yet collected their printed driver's license cards are able to do so at any of the listed locations if their applications were dropped off at those locations. Taxpayers will be able to access taxpayer service activities, including processing motor vehicle registration and other motor vehicle transactions, applying for a taxpayer registration number TRN, dropping off documents for the renewal of their driver's license, and make tax and fee payments, as the tax authority says it continues to provide additional access to its services. Audit and compliance activities will not be available during the Saturday operations. In Thursday's trading session, the JSE Combined Index declined by 3,376 points to close at over 433,000 units. Overall market activity resulted from trading in 94 stocks, of which 45 advanced, 38 declined, and 11 traded firm. The Junior Market Index advanced by 21 points to close at over 3,000 units. Stocks advanced for Access Financial Services Limited, AMG Packaging and Paper Company Limited, and Marita Investments Limited. Stocks declined for Caribbean Assurance Brokers Limited, Caribbean Cement Company Limited, and Caribbean Cream Limited. Trading firm were Siboney Group Limited, Epley 7.5% Preference Shares, and Future Energy Source Company Limited Ordinary Shares. Dolphin Cove Limited was the volume leader with over 1.5 million units, followed by Mailpack Group Limited with 1.5 million units, and Jamaican Teas Limited with over 1.3 million units. In foreign exchange trading for Thursday, June 24, the US dollar sold for an average $150.48. The Canadian dollar ended trading at over $124. The pound sterling traded for $209.62, and the euro sold for an average $181.78. And on that note, we close this extended edition of the Business Report Inside the News on PBCJ. I'm Gabrielle Thompson. Pleasant viewing.
In regional news, more than 100,000 people in Guyana have received both their first and second doses of the three COVID-19 vaccines administered locally and are now deemed to be fully immunized against the severe effects of the disease COVID-19. This is according to Health Minister Dr. Frank Anthony, who spoke during his daily COVID-19 update on Wednesday.
A total of 229,053 people, or 47.1% of the targeted adult population, have received either their first dose of the AstraZeneca, Sinopharm, or Sputnik V vaccines that are currently used in Guyana's vaccination rollout, according to Health Minister Dr. Frank Anthony. The minister also noted that more than 100,000 people received both their first and second doses of the vaccine.
With second dose, we have now achieved, I would say, a milestone, because we are now at 101,246 persons who would have received their second dose. This would be approximately 20.8% of our population. And I think this is a milestone worth celebrating, because approximately 20% of our population is now fully immunized. And as we have said before, with persons who have received both doses of their vaccines, we have not seen any of those persons coming to the hospital, meaning that they don't get the severe form of the infection, nor have they been admitted to any of our ICUs or die from COVID. So I think that's a very important thing for people to understand.
Meanwhile, the health minister also noted that about 75% of the people aged 60 years and older, or about 3/4 of that population, have also now received their COVID-19 vaccines. The minister also addressed concerns over the continued delay in the supply of the second doses of the Sputnik V COVID-19 vaccines, which he previously said may have been caused by a surge in the cases in Moscow, Russia.
We continue to work to try to get those vaccines into Guyana. But I want to make this point as well. One, you have between 4 weeks to 12 weeks to get your second dose. We have not exceeded that 12 weeks yet. And we are working very hard to make sure that we get those second doses in before that 12 weeks expire. Because initially what we were doing, and that's before we were informed by the Gamaleya Institute that you can go up to 12 weeks, we were literally writing on the card, come back in 4 weeks. But they have since given us the scientific evidence, they have since given us additional information, and they have told us that they have changed the protocol to go between 4 to 12 weeks. So most people who have received their first dose vaccines, they have not exceeded that 12 weeks, right? So we still have time. We are working very hard to make sure that we can get those vaccines in, and I am reassured that we will get it before that 12 weeks expire.
In the meantime, the health minister has encouraged people who are not yet vaccinated to go take their vaccines at any of the vaccination centers across Guyana. Reporting for the newsroom, I am Vishani Raghavir.
The Bahamian government is seeking a stay in the appeals court following a landmark citizenship decision, and the Attorney General's office is also seeking to have the case fast-tracked in the Privy Council. Jasmine Brown of Our News has the details in this report.
While the Attorney General had a lot to say in the Senate, much of what he had to say focused on what's happening here at the Attorney General's office, where he says his team is working hard to have that case heard quickly.
The dog that I have in the hunt, and I say I have a dog in the hunt, is certainty in the law. It is critically important. And so while my friend, somewhat insouciantly, I suppose, may want to say that there's some uncertainty, it is my job to point to the certainty that is in the law.
Beth revealed the government's plan to apply for a stay in the Court of Appeal. He once again stressed the law has not changed despite the ruling because the government is planning to appeal to the Privy Council. He says the AG's office is looking to have the case expedited in the Privy Council so that the matter can be determined sooner rather than later.
Just be patient, because it won't be long. This is such an urgent matter, and I'm sure that the Privy Council is going to give it. See, it isn't a bunch of there's no factual disputes, purely a question of constitutional construction. And I'm sure that this will be given the kind of priority, so vital and important a matter is, by the Privy Council, that we're talking perhaps no more than several months at the very latest, in my view. And we will be applying for accelerated treatment by the court.
The Court of Appeal upheld a Supreme Court ruling that children born out of wedlock to Bahamian men and foreign women in the Bahamas are entitled to citizenship from birth. On Wednesday morning, Bethel said individuals have been turning up at the Parliamentary Registration Department demanding to be registered to vote. Opposition Senator Fred Mitchell said in the Senate that at this point, Bethel needs to remain mum on the matter.
I tried to advise and admonish the Attorney General to stay out of this matter this morning, because there's nothing he can say which will clarify or put an end to the argument in the public domain.
The AG pleaded with the public to be patient as the matter works its way through the courts. Reporting for Our News, I'm Jasmine Brown.
The sea urchin or sea egg populations in the waters of the Eastern Caribbean, including St. Lucia, are said to be under immense pressure. This from the latest studies on that fishery. Now, a concerned citizen in the south of St. Lucia is ringing alarm bells over the wanton poaching of the species.
Despite this being the closed season for sea eggs, there's mounting evidence of brisk business in the harvesting of the fishery. The pristine Safi Beach in Labri is now littered with shells of sea urchins piled in heaps along the shoreline. One concerned citizen spoke to NewsForce about the closed season harvesting of the sea eggs. He claims that the divers from the neighboring community of Viewfort are the ones involved in the poaching.
Over 6 weeks, I'm seeing these things happening. And they have about three different set of fellas. Break it, going out there, taking sea eggs, break it, drop it in the wave, because they're in a hurry. Because they just come to evacuate the place, I guess. So And I called the cops. They said there's nothing they can do about that. I finally find out fisheries number, call the fisheries department. That was last week, Wednesday. They said they are coming now. They never came until after 5 in the afternoon. So which means somebody else, how would View Fashion feel if it was Laborians that was living Labri and come and do that kind of thing in Viewfort? How would they feel?
News Force obtained footage of the poachers in action out in the bay diving, apparently for sea eggs. According to our source, before the commercial scale poaching, the sea eggs could be found a few feet from the shoreline. Now the divers are forced to go some distance out to harvest them because of the rapid rate of depletion of the sea egg population in the area.
What I saw was the same thing they were doing in Viewfort. That's the reason why they can't find none up there right now. They used to drop the shells in the waves and it going back to the ocean and it chasing those that there. Right now they are there and they have to go all the way out there to get a bag. Okay, just for 6 weeks, and they already evacuate everything that was in the harbor there. So I wonder if somebody else gonna take it to the next level, because I try my best. And I can say I gain less. I wonder if it's in season or if it's out of season, because I don't know what's going on right now there, because I can't understand that.
Unlike most species, there's no fixed date for the reopening of the sea egg harvesting season in St. Lucia. The decision to open the season depends on the assessment by the fisheries department of the viability of the population of that fishery. The lifespan of the sea eggs is about 3 years. This means that the fishery has to be properly managed in order to avoid a collapse of the population. The fisheries department's efforts to manage the sea egg population are being hampered by the unlawful harvesting of the fishery in the closed season. The concerned citizen says the divers are demonstrating no regard for the long-term survival of the species or the care of the environment.
It's not one spot. They have about 6 or 7 different spots where they make big heaps of shells, you know. And it's the ocean that cleaning it back, you see. So that's not good. And the place stinks for weeks, you know. People passing and they saying there stinks. And most of the people are wrong. They know I'm a diver. They're thinking I'm the one doing it.
The commercial harvesting operation of sea eggs in Labri and along the southwestern coast have been going on for weeks. The concerned citizen wants the fisheries authorities to step in and end the unlawful activity, which is threatening the sea egg population in the area. Stanley Lucien for the HTS News Force.
In sports, we put the spotlight on athletics. The Jamaica Athletics Administrative Association, JAAA's Ministry of Health Supreme Ventures National Senior Championships kicked off at the National Stadium. Among the highlights was a promised showdown in the marquee event, the women's 100 meters. World and Olympic Games 400 meters medalist Sharika Jackson clocked a new personal best, 10.91 seconds, to win her heat to head into the semifinals with the fastest time. Olympic double sprint champion Elaine Thompson-Herra ran 10.96 seconds, and world champion Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce clocked 10.97 to both win their respective heats. This sets up what is expected to be a fast semifinal and final Friday evening. World Under-20 champion Brianna Williams, Kemba Nelson, and Natasha Morrison, who have all had sub-11 runs this year, have also advanced to the semifinals. And that's our package. On behalf of our entire production crew, we say thank you so much for watching the news right here on PBCJ.